My name is Theo Collet. I'm from France. I'm a student in film and television, and this is my last year in Scala. What draws me to this subject is mostly like the human rights. I think like for me it's something really important, and I feel like, you know, the coverage of it is really not well done in a way, because, you know, like you have the news and everything like telling you stuff, but they're really trying to look for the sensational stuff. Let's try to understand it by myself and like maybe give another look to people, you know. That's why like I decided to cover such subjects. Like the first one was in refugee camps in Jordan, like about the Syrian refugees. Now it's in Mexico, like migrants actually trying to cross. So, you know, it's like different stories, because one is war, one is like misery that push people to move somewhere else. And but they still relate to like something, to a specific story. You know, like I tried to get a big story, basically, like for example the war in Syria, the migration to the US, and then I'll go in it, find some people. So in this case, I found two young people in Mexico that were from Honduras. And through these guys, I'm trying to tell a story, you know, like these guys would be like the representation of what's happening, you know, because of course they're like, you know, not everyone is the same, but they all come in a way because of the same reasons. I didn't know much about Mexico and the situation of the migrants. I decided to make that because we're in the US, I think it's important for Americans to know what's happening at their border. I like the last part of the trip of those guys, because, you know, they have so much going on before coming, and then they reach that part, the border, and, you know, it's not that simple. It's like, it's not people just cross in one day and that's it. It's like they stay months, they try to make money. It costs a lot because of the human traffickers and stuff. I interviewed a human trafficker, and so that was pretty, that's one of the memories I have. It's pretty scary, actually. You know, since I came there, I have a fixer. So a fixer is basically your guide when you come to a place where you don't know anything, you know. So it's like a local guide. He is also your translator. He's gonna get you in contact with the right people you're looking for. So he's the guy that knows everything, you know. And that guy lives in slums, and he's, you know, he's surrounded by people that are just like into the human trafficking business, the drug business, the gun business, like all those kind of bad stuff. And he was in contact with human traffickers, so I tried to get him to lead me to an interview with a guy, you know, that he knew. And one day in the street, I went to talk to him, and then he calls a guy, and it was the name of the guy he talked to me about, so the human trafficker, so he's right here. And he's like, he comes to him, he's like, this is Theo, he's the student I talked to you about, he wants to do an interview, like quick one and stuff. And I see like a guy, he's like in his 50s. You know, like in countries like Mexico, gang members that are like in their 50s, you know, they survived, you know, like they're pretty good at what they do, you know, because they're still alive. He looks at me very intensely, like he gets close to me, then he just tells me like, cigarettes, you know, like the way he was talking to me, it was like, wow. Like, I gave it to him, then he's like, okay, I'm gonna go to the restaurant, meet me there, like I'll eat and then you can interview me. So we go with my son, I brought a son guy from SCAD, and we just enter that small restaurant where he's eating, and I tell him, can you first cover your face, because like I don't want you to get in trouble because of me, because, you know, I'm not trying to protect those guys, but like, you know, it's like, if I'm responsible for him getting arrested, I can get in troubles, like big troubles, but also my fixer, because he's the one living here, you know. I'm leaving Mexico, but he's staying here, so like, if he brought me and like, you know, police finds him and then he gets arrested, this guy gets killed, basically. So I tell him that, and he just goes like, no, but I'm wanted by the police everywhere, so like in the whole world. So no, I'm not covering my face. I tell him, do you want to go to a better place for the interview, like more quiet? Because you're in the middle of a restaurant, you know, you're gonna talk about illegal stuff. It's just like, I don't think it's the right place for you to talk about it. And he tells me that, like, no, we do it here, everyone is scared of me here. Like the whole, and you see, like, the people around don't even look at him or look at us, they're just like looking at the floor. I needed to set up my tripod, and like we didn't have space because it was a small restaurant. There was a guy eating, and I tell him, like, can you translate to him, like if we can push him a little bit, like with the table, so we can have space for the tripod. And the guy goes like that, you know, he gets a sign, and we start, the guy just, we start pushing the table and the guy gets crushed on the wall, you know, it's like, it's just so weird, you know, like, the guy is not saying anything, he's just like looking at the ground, it's like, pushing him against the wall, it's just like, so you see like how much influence that guy has. And his nickname was Tripas in Spanish, it means the guts, you know, and like, all those guys have like, nicknames and it means, you know, like this guy is a murderer basically. Like, and yeah, at the end that guy was like, it was nice to meet you, but like next time you come to Mexicali, come to the tunnels with me or come to the favelas, the slums with me, and then I'll get you to LA in 2 hours. Like I don't even charge. Like, no.
With the Trump administration, they're building a new wall, which I witnessed. It's like a wall that's double the size of like the previous one, you know. So it's a really tough situation, and I think that's why it was important to be made, you know.
Just sitting down in a tent with like refugees and just like being part of their life, you know, it's true, you know. It's like you come as a foreigner, you don't know much about it. I mean, I know it from like statistics, from the news and stuff. So it kind of shocked me to see like on TV people represented as like numbers, statistics, you know. So like, you know, seeing, my God, like 500,000 people died in Syria over the war. It's like, you're like, wow, it's a big number, but you don't really feel connected to the thing. When I go there and I film like, you know, just one Syrian, you know, it just like gives you such a huge portrait of the person, you know, and like how important it is that those guys survive and like, you know, try to move to other countries for like, you know, to have a better life. Just like those moments spending with like people, you know, and like you have moments that are pretty beautiful, you know, with like you're surrounded by kids, like refugee kids. You just feel like something cool. You have also extremely sad moments. One day I was invited in a tent where like they had like 3 kids, and one of them, like I brought a lot of toys with me just to offer like to the kids, and so I give a little card to like every one of the kids, and I see one of them, he tries to like destroy it, but like with such violence, like why would you do that, you know? And I see it like giving so much power in it, and the kid was like 4 or 5 years old. And then he loses all his energy and he falls on the ground, and then I see like a bomb exploded and like went into his head, you know, he had like a huge mark here. And it's shocking, not because of what it is, but like, you see that kid, he was like 4 years old, I went there in 2017, so it means that he was born during the war, and you have that generation of kids that just lost because they just know war, they just know violence, that's all they know, and that's all they're gonna do because they were born that way, you know. And it's really eye-opening, shocking, it's really sad also because, you know, here we're living in a bubble, you know, and like most of the world is misery, and here we don't realize that we just like so privileged, like whoever we are, we're living in a place where it's like peaceful, you know, like we don't have misery, you know, we have roads, we have cars, and you go to other countries where like just kids are getting killed, like you know, they don't mean anything. You bring a story to people that's real, and you also leave something yourself, you know. And for every documentary, you know, it doesn't need to be like that, you know, it doesn't need to be that intense. You don't need to go to like a war zone or the most dangerous place on earth. You'll still learn something, you know, by spending time with people that you don't know, that you don't expect to know, you know. You can have people that you don't agree with, you know, but it's good to understand them also. Like, it's very good to ask the right questions and to also be extremely open-minded, like to be able to change your mind, you know. I'm not trying to sell a vision I have, you know, because I have my own vision, but I'm just trying to show you like the truth as close as I can, you know, because this, you know, a film about 2 migrants is not showing you the whole migrant story, but like then you make your own mind about it, you know, like do those guys are like have the right to come here, like, and you ask the right questions yourself, and then you're like, maybe I want to learn more, so I'll go myself or find other stuff. And I'm just trying to have people asking the right questions, that's all, like, and be more open-minded and open to the differences, you know, like differences in political ideas, differences in culture and everything, yeah.